we are entering the second segment of our show this morning. And we have with us on set none other than Lisa Schulman. You guys know her as a lawyer and as an activist. And of course, she's joining us on set this morning to discuss laws as it regulates, or legal matters that regulate revenge porn,
sexual cyberbullying,
yes, and things of the like.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I came in saying I don't feel my normal bright self. Normally, mm-hmm, I love Monday mornings and bright.
This was a terrible
weekend. I'm in black. Mm-hmm. There's a reason. I've been posting in black. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of things that we need to work through as a society. Mm-hmm. And this issue of sexual cyberbullying and what some people call revenge porn, mm-hmm, is very much on my mind. Mm-hmm. Also child sexual abuse, but that's a whole other topic, I think. Yeah. Yes and
but
no,
sometimes
actually.
Mixed
yes
in.
And no, yes. Because part of what we're going to talk about this morning is child sexual abuse. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
So I want to start off with just a clear definition as to what exists in our laws,
right,
to protect any person from being a victim in this situation.
Okay. First of all, there are laws protecting minors. Mm-hmm. We have a Commercial Sexual Exploitation Act,
yeah,
that protects minors. This was passed 6 years ago in 2013. Mm-hmm. It is very strong for those of you out there who have a video of a 15-year-old engaged in a sexual act and it is on your device. You are breaking the law.
Because you are liable. It's child pornography.
It's child pornography, and you are liable for possession,
yeah,
for up to 12 years. So they make no.
You're liable for possession. You're liable
for sharing.
Mm-hmm.
Producing, mm-hmm, distributing, mm-hmm, almost every single form of being connected with that video, and it is very strong because even if you share it by other means other than the internet, other than social media, you're still liable.
One and of even the most if you share it in private.
Things, yes, exactly.
Yeah.
One of the most pernicious things about the entire weekend episode is that things weren't being shared on Facebook where they can be reported and taken, mm-hmm, down immediately.
Mm-hmm. They it's were being WhatsApp, shared the videos WhatsApp.
Via
are going
WhatsApp
around.
And in a few cases via Messenger inbox.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's harder on Messenger inbox, but you can report it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. WhatsApp is absolutely difficult to police.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But for those of you who possess any of those videos, you are liable for a criminal offense.
Let me give an example. So there is a video of a minor,
right,
that was distributed this weekend.
Right.
If I receive it,
yes,
in my WhatsApp from,
yes,
Isani,
yes,
and I take a screenshot showing, proving that Isani sent me a video of a minor.
Right. Mm-hmm. You could report it to the
police. I can report him.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
Yeah. And he is liable for child pornography, distributing,
yes,
child pornography charges.
And possession.
And possession.
Yeah.
Because he has sent it to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Not that Isani would ever do that, but yes. I'll tell you, there's a number of people who have said to me, I opened it because I didn't know what it was.
Mm-hmm.
The moment you become aware of what it is, mm-hmm, the right thing to do is to delete it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
There's no reason for you to have to possess it. Mm-hmm. Seriously.
Mm-hmm. Right? And look at the propagation of it as well. I mean, sometimes we get things on our phone and like, why? Whoa, this is interesting. This is weird. And then automatically you send it into another group, and
yeah,
then things, yeah, just take off from,
yeah,
there.
There is no reason for
but that's
you
where
to
you're not thinking
of
personal
this,
responsibility.
Because it is about personal responsibility.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I put up a post saying, you know, if you share this video, you're scum.
Mm-hmm.
If you're looking for the video, you're scum.
Mm-hmm.
If you leak the video, you're scum.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes double if you're dealing with the one with a minor.
Mm-hmm.
Now let me ask you this, because we began this conversation off camera earlier, but
yes,
I think it's something that I want to raise,
sure,
in this forum. Perhaps ultimately it boils down to a decision, perhaps in this case, of two consenting adults.
Right.
I won't look at the one involving the minor, but
right,
I look at perhaps a video that is being recorded where there's an act of intimacy between adults,
yeah,
consenting adults. They agree,
yeah,
you know what, you can video me, etc., etc.
Mm-hmm.
And then down the road, you know,
For some reason, one of the parties puts it out there.
They go their separate ways,
yeah.
But that wasn't an amicable breakup, so the person decides, you know what, let me get back to him or let me get back to her by doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And they automatically hit the send button,
mm-hmm.
and we are where we are today.
Yes.
How does one begin to deal with an issue such as that? Not only from a psychological perspective, because the damage done would be tremendous, I'm assuming, but more from a legal perspective. What measures can one take as an adult, if there's any?
It's really difficult. Look, everybody makes personal decisions,
mm-hmm.
and whether you initially consent or not, you have an absolute right to privacy.
Mm-hmm.
The Constitution guarantees you the right to privacy. The problem is, we don't have laws like in Trinidad that criminalize the unauthorized distribution of images or video, okay? There was a woman by the name of Therese Ho, whose ex-lover released photographs and I think videos of her, and she took him to court and won damages. This was only a couple of years ago, mm-hmm. 2016, and the case was sensational in the Caribbean.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, almost everybody in Belize said, that's what we need. To date, it hasn't been done, and it needs to be done. Because I keep saying to people, those of us who grew up in my generation
mm-hmm.
didn't grow up with social media. So many of us never had any expectation that mm-hmm. there would ever be the rapid, almost instantaneous means of distribution that mm-hmm. there are now. Things go viral within a matter of minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Once upon a time, when you would hear allegations, for instance, of the Bishop brothers
mm-hmm.
Taking videos of young ladies, you had to actually know somebody who had the video and would show it to
mm-hmm.
you. Not anymore. This is a recording device.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody has one of these. It's a recording device. It's also a distribution device.
Mm-hmm.
So it happens very rapidly. I put up a hashtag this weekend, and it said, it could be me.
Mm-hmm.
Why did I say that? It could be me. We're all adults. We've all made choices in our life for right or for wrong.
Mm-hmm.
We've all trusted people for right or for wrong. And you never know who is going to betray your trust until they actually betray your
mm-hmm.
trust. So let us stop hitting at the women and the girls
mm-hmm.
who have either consented or are unknowing as to what happened.
Mm-hmm.
They have an absolute right to privacy. Other than if you voluntarily put your material out there,
mm-hmm.
you have an absolute right to privacy. It's nobody's business, and I have said, the day anybody wants to put unauthorized images of me out there,
mm-hmm.
I am going to stand up and say, you scumbucket, you have no right, and the rest of you, this is none of your business.
Mm-hmm.
I am not going to be ashamed of it.
Mm-hmm.
I am not going to walk away from it, and I am going to take whatever consequences come, because it is only until we stand up
mm-hmm.
against bullies, whether they are cyber bullies or bullies in real life,
mm-hmm.
things don't change. But what we need is a law.
Well, that's
need
what I was
now.
Going to say, because the
now.
Strength it takes to stand up
yes.
and face the consequences of having your
right.
private moments put out there,
yes.
I think is one that is clearly understated in what you're saying.
It's horrendous.
I truly believe you would do that. But my fundamental point, and I think this is where I get concerned a lot of times with the movements we see in Belize.
Yes.
People are great at social media support. They'll like and love and share
yes.
a hashtag.
But,
yes.
but that is
life.
Never enough.
It isn't enough.
It is not
no.
enough to say privately
no.
or on Facebook, oh, I'm
you.
With you,
yeah.
I support you, or send a private inbox.
Mm-hmm.
If we want to agitate for change, it goes way beyond the hashtag. And
it
I can't even tell you how many times I've said that on this
yeah.
show. So we have marches and rallies, and we get upset, and
yeah.
then as the stereotypical thing,
yeah.
it blows over like a Lee Breeze,
yes.
right?
And I am not a fan of marches and rallies.
Mm-hmm.
I understand them. I get the need. But That's not where I am. So you'll be happy to hear that's supported by a small group of women and a couple of men, some of which are lawyers, some of which are lay people. Mm-hmm. I've already started the drafting of a cyberbullying law for adults. And we don't have to reinvent any wheel. Mm-hmm. What we're doing is we're taking some of the strongest laws that we've seen anywhere and combining them with things like Trinidad, which is a Commonwealth country. But we can learn from anywhere. For instance, Illinois has one of the strongest laws where even if you initially consented, if your material is put out there, you can absolutely go after the person. And it's criminalizing the person who did that to you. So that is one of the strongest standards. Also, the person who shares it, prosecutors don't actually have to prove malice. Mm-hmm. In other words, you don't have to prove that you meant to cause harm to the mm-hmm. person by sharing. Mm-hmm. The simple act of sharing is criminalized. And this is how it is with minors. Mm-hmm. If we're willing to protect minors like this, and we should be, mm-hmm. we have to be able to protect adults like this too.
But there's a larger issue here, which mm-hmm. I think that always makes videos and images that go on the internet or that are stored on any internet site difficult to go after, because the World Wide Web is exactly that. It's the World
Wide
Web.
Yes, except that, as somebody pointed out, your IP address is your identity.
No, I know. I'm not talking about getting
so you could. We don't. The problem is in Belize, the police does not have a cybercrime unit. Mm-hmm. I get that. However,
but can CETO help? There's CETO.
Yes. Absolutely, CETO can help. Absolutely. And not only that, Marlene, these things aren't rocket science. Give me two or three clever hacker kids and I can find anybody. Mm-hmm. And I guarantee you those kids can be found right here in Belize. Mm-hmm. And I know you can put together a dedicated unit of even volunteers to track this mm-hmm. down. Mm-hmm. You know, so some of you, and we've all, at least in theory, had to register our phone numbers. So mm-hmm. you could edit a WhatsApp thing and think nobody don't know where they say. Mm-hmm. But, because by the way, large countries, like for instance the United States, when they want to target people, they find you. All of El Chapo's communications were known.
Yeah, even secret messaging sites can be gotten into. I've always said that. Yes. Fake profiles are easy to discover.
Yes.
But going back to what our laws mm-hmm. currently allow for. So we're saying that there is nothing that protects.
No, I'm not saying
okay, that's
nothing.
What I'm trying to say. I want to know what avenues
exist. I'm saying there's no particular law for cyberbullying. For instance, the Commissioner of Police pointed out to me, and he's right, mm-hmm. there is a law against distribution of pornographic material. Mm-hmm. But you see, that's not enough. This isn't that. Pornographic material is, the distribution of pornographic material is an old law that is morality-based mm-hmm. that has a judgment as to what it is. This isn't that.
So distributing pornography comes at what type of offense?
That is a criminal offense under the criminal code, mm-hmm. right? But it's antiquated. What we are looking at is something completely different. Because mm-hmm. it's not just distribution, it's possession mm-hmm. of unauthorized images. And it will take a marriage between copyright law mm-hmm. and criminal law for this to be addressed. And not only that, there needs to be some law that provides for civil penalties. In other words, so that I can sue those persons who put my images out there mm-hmm. without my authorization and get damages, because I'm telling you, some people are not going to stop until they pocket feel.
But you see,
or until they get locked up for do this.
There's laws, yes. And then there's culture.
And then there's culture. And I always say, culture are the hardest thing for
change. And that's really where I wanted to kind of figure out how we can tie the two together. But let me
sure.
Because if somebody takes images of me.
Yes.
And I have to decide whether or not I want to pursue a case against mm-hmm. that person. One of the things I have to be very cognizant of, I'll do several analysis. I do my pros and cons. So, okay, I will make sure they know they can never do it to another person again. Right. They will know that they were wrong. Right. They will face the consequences. Mm-hmm. But then also on a personal level, if I have an issue like this and it is publicized, even though in the law it says it should be discreet, it will be publicized. It goes to the police department and people know.
Everybody see the evidence.
Then what I have done is incited interest for the material that this person possessed. So do I want to punish him or do I and face the consequences of having it released, or do I want to just have it go away?
I hear you.
And that is the struggle. That's what the laws that currently exist. Real example.
Yes, and that is a personal choice. Let me tell you, a lot of people started posting angry things about what happened, particularly what happened to the well-known media person. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to say names because I don't believe, even though
it's
names are in public domain, it is re-victimization. Okay, so that's out there. My thing was this. When the backlash started, oh, you only care about so-and-so because so-and-so is a big person, is a famous person, is a this person. You know what I said? Stop. It doesn't matter if you always cared. It doesn't matter if you care now. What matters is that you care, and more importantly, that we do something about this. Because sometimes people don't get it until it hits close to home. Rosa Parks.
I was about to use that example.
And not only that, people don't notice.
She was not the first.
She was chosen by the NAACP for the way she looked, carried herself and behaved to be the model citizen to whom this would occur.
Yeah.
And so a suit could be brought. People don't realize that sometimes it takes the straw that breaks the camel's back for people to get up.
And you have a question. Yeah, I just want to throw in a comment here because I know that that's what people are saying, and it is very discouraging to read it and to see it. But here's what I want to say, because I can say this much for this show. We've covered this issue many times. There's a certain point where people start to pay attention, and it does happen when it hits close to home. It's like when you start to pay attention to cancer or to sexual abuse or police brutality when it happens to your family.
Yes.
And when you work on television, you know this as a reporter, people welcome you into their homes. You feel they feel like you're a part of their family. Mm-hmm. And that's why it has the widespread effect that it does.
Correct.
But what you said with Rosa Parks, I think, is really one of the things that I've kept on thinking about. You know, people feel she was the first, that it was a novel issue. But really, it had been done before.
It had been happening for decades.
But it was the tipping point. It was the time where
and
we
maybe
said,
this is the tipping
no
point.
More.
So
this
here's
is
my question.
The tipping point,
Well, I understand that this particular conversation focuses on the legal aspect or the potential legal remedies, if there were. We're not looking at the trauma that this has created perhaps on an individual level.
Of course.
You're humiliated, so you have an emotional issue to deal with. You have a psychological issue to deal with as well. You step out of your front door, for instance, and everybody looks at you like, there goes that person that was on the video. Now, that can force you to depression, suicide, and all these other things.
Yes.
And I think that perhaps as a society, we're not focusing on what those potential consequences are.
Isani, I'm going to say something that's going to get me into a lot of trouble. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we're not a society that focuses on consequences. We want our instant gratification, and we want it now. I was personally shocked, and I don't care if people think I'm naive. Mm-hmm. I was personally shocked by the level of hatred, envy, bad-mindedness that I saw being displayed on social media this weekend with people that I thought better of saying, well, what do you expect? She looked for that. Mm-hmm. Or too bad, too sad, ha ha, how the mighty have fallen kind of comment. In 2008, when I returned to Belize, I started hearing from women who were victimized. There was a website that I won't call the name of. It was pretty famous at the time. It was a pay-for-play site. Mm-hmm. In other words, if you paid the money, you get access to the site. You could say, folders of people's images. Mm-hmm. And a young woman came to see me very distressed because her image was there. And she didn't want any noise because she was employed, gainfully employed in a sensitive profession. Mm-hmm. Leave it at that. We got her picture down. I got her picture down. How? Not because it was pornography or obscene, because it was copyright. Mm-hmm. And I threatened the host of that particular website, the web host, and said, if you do not take this down, I'm going to sue you for copyright infringement in the States because you are using an authorized copy of my client's image.
Mm-hmm. Unauthorized. Yeah.
Came down like that. Fast forward to today. The same person laments, where was this support when I was being victimized? Mm-hmm. The truth is, this person did not want the complaint to be out there. Mm-hmm. And I understand, Marlene. I get it. It's a personal choice. Not everybody can withstand the scrutiny. I'm never going to be humiliated by my private images, mm-hmm. because guess what? When I took those images, I knew what the potential consequences were. Mm-hmm. Although, obviously, those were not in the days when social media existed. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't matter. It's out there. I'm not going to be humiliated by it because guess what? I took a decision. Nobody wants to shame me.
But
nobody wants to shame me like that because that is me. But everybody does not have that luxury.
Yes.
And I get it because there are people. Let's take the issue of the teacher at, the school in Orange Walk. Okay? That teacher was suspended.
And she's fighting her case.
She is. And it's going through the thing. And I think Minister Faber was asked about it. He said he didn't know the details. Mm-hmm. But that is because it is going through the system. And that actually doesn't require ministerial interference. Mm-hmm. It requires for the administration to do the right thing. And hear what? They're a granting aid school, which means they take money from the government, so they better not be violating this woman's privacy, or there's a constitutional case.
But can a person lose a job? And I mean, you're talking about labor laws here as well.
I would say a person should not lose their job.
If there's an explicit morality clause in or policy when I go to a job.
As long as you did not voluntarily put the images out there, you have an absolute right to your privacy.
Otherwise, it's an invasion of your privacy.
It's that simple. So it's not even a labor law issue. It's a constitutional privacy issue. Mm-hmm. And because the state is involved, because they give funding to the school, the Maria Roches case says it can't be done. Mm-hmm. It cannot be done. But where I want us to get as a society is not only that we have laws to penalize you, slap you on the hand, charge you, lock you up. I want us to get to the position where we understand that this is just wrong. It's just evil. You have no business in somebody else's business. I don't know that we'll ever get there. But at the very least, what we can do is you've got two choices when one of those images are shared. You can delete it or you can report it. Mm-hmm. As far as I'm concerned, those are your two choices. You can't police morality. Mm-hmm. This is
and you
problem.
Can't force people to be empathetic.
No, you can't. In fact, there is a law that says if you see child abuse, you are to report it. Mm-hmm. You know what? It has no penalty. It actually has, it's written in the law that you have an obligation, but even the law recognizes that you can't put penalties on that.
So what type of legislation will strengthen the protection mechanisms for persons who fall victim?
We need cyberbullying laws that mirror what is already in the law for commercial sexual exploitation of children. And we need the laws to be twofold. There has to be a criminalization of the act, specifically. And Illinois is a good example to follow. But there also has to be civil penalties, in other words, that I can sue you for it and get damages. Because I tell you, some people know and feel it, even if you lock me up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The when you get on court judgment and they lose their house and their car and their whatever,
then they will feel. Of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But what it doesn't change, no matter what the laws say, is the culture part. And I think that's where I am concerned. Yes. There's a case that sticks with me, and I don't think I will ever let it go. It is the case of the two mentally ill persons being coerced into a sexual act and recorded.
Then a video. And then a video.
And it was, the, I mean, that case for
and
me
the
was...
the avidity with which people were sharing and... No, I totally,
it will forever be a scar on what I perceive of more people.
To me, what we, how we treat persons with disabilities is one of the biggest cultural crimes in this country, because we don't have laws, but worse than that, we don't care.
Nor regard.
It's almost as though those people were subhuman, that they were children of a lesser god. So we don't care about them. It almost looks like victimless crime. And on top of everything else, people laugh and they don't care. This is the society when we have become. So if you want to start asking why we have so much crime, why we have so much murder, this is why. We fail to have regard for human life. We really do. And that no amount of laws could change that.
And that is the thing, right? Because now you're looking at technological advancements that allow us to be able to spread images and audio recordings and what have you in the blink of an eye.
Yes.
And then that goes smack against perhaps the values that you were taught as a person.
Correct.
Because then at home, before all of the WhatsApp and the social media came about, our parents taught us that you don't do this, you don't do that, you respect the integrity and the humanity of the next
another person,
etc. But now with the phones and the cameras and all of these things, there's a direct conflict.
You see this? This is just a tool. It still comes back
the
to personal responsibility.
The person.
Nothing can share that unless somebody do it. That's the base of it. That is the base of it. Please, if you're out there and you have these images, get rid of them. But also don't re-victimize the person by calling their name, calling them out. Even if you think you are doing this in a good cause. One particular post that was very galling to me was a post that purported to be from the significant other. And it was basically fingering somebody else and exculpating themselves. To me, there's no point to that. If you know that never you do it, hold your corner. You no need to put it out there. Because people were sharing and resharing that. And then that also in and of itself became a thing. I get it that the person may have, I'm sure the person must have had the very best intention. But the instinct is, I think, not the right one. Every time you share, every time you mention, every time you put up the image, every time you call the name, every time you reveal the circumstances, you are re-victimizing the person, and you're right, Isani, we're not thinking about the trauma. And it is trauma. And
of
I mean, I could sit on here and tell you that nobody will make me feel ashamed, but I can't tell you until it happens to me.
Until you walk in the shoes,
how it's going to affect me, how it really will affect me. I promise you that I'm a body told because that's my personality.
But it won't mean that you won't have moments of weaknesses or
it
struggle.
It doesn't mean that I won't suffer. That it doesn't mean that it won't traumatize me because it has to. We're all human.
But what we're talking about, you know, and Isani mentioned something I think that's so important. It's a value system issues, and it and it really, you know, this goes way beyond videos and pictures. It and I think that's where I just I read and I have a lot of hope as to where we can go from here. As I said, it could be a tipping point. Because what we've seen for so long is a lack of, and I'm using empathy because that's the mildest word I can come up with.
No, it is empathy. Where you don't see the humanity in somebody else.
The, yeah, it's for me it's a lack of humanity. When I see that people are okay talking badly about a child who's been a victim of sexual abuse, when
or
a runaway child is assumed to be a bad girl wagon with a man, never knowing the circumstances, never knowing the child. When we hear a woman or even a man being blasted in any particular way, that we just love the dirtiest details
of it. We rejoice in it. We wallow in it.
And so this is a larger society. And I'm not on a soapbox. I'm not, I really am trying not to be on a soapbox. But what I'm saying is, we have identified it as an issue. And when issues like this take place, I saw saw so many people comment on the rights and wrongs of the Muffles teachers case.
Yes.
And, you know, so many people who are experts on what should and shouldn't be done. And my question just is, where is your humanity in the suffering of another person?
Where is your personal responsibility?
Yeah.
No, it's that is clear to me. It's absolutely clear to me. And I think if there is anything that we should take away from this, it is the understanding that your personal decisions affect everybody. It's chaos theory. Yeah. The notion that the one movement of a butterfly wing will set off a chain of events that rock the world. That's at base what it is. And so you're not on a soapbox, I'm on a soapbox. I'm here because of a soapbox. Because if somebody doesn't stand up and say, this is wrong, this is what we need to do. I don't think it's that we don't know what the problem is. I think it's that we get mired in the millions of other problems that we have. Because
you know
the
I
moment
think?
You stand up on this, mm-hmm. people are saying, yes, but why you no care about the people where they get killed on George Street?
And this is where
and
I was
it's,
going
it's
with that.
It's not that. One doesn't mean dealing with one thing mm-hmm. doesn't mean you care less about another thing.
Yeah.
But everybody cannot do everything at once.
Lisa, bring the meal scenario.
We have an appetite.
Yes.
A voraciousness for things that are scandalous, mm-hmm. things that are gory and
we
violent and bloody and sexual.
Yeah.
That is who
news.
We've become. So that, as you mentioned earlier, I go online scouring certain areas of the social media realm just to find the gore, the salaciousness, the this, that,
I
and the other.
I am gobsmacked.
People
by
turn on the news to find out whose scandal is up next and all of these
back,
other things.
For instance.
But not only that, when there's a major murder that takes place, it is actually said, I can't wait to see news.
Exactly.
Yes.
And it's part, as Marlene said, it's part of the culture that we have cultivated, so
Look,
to speak.
I will tell you this. Every time I am disheartened by how many people support a stop bav kind mm-hmm. of page, I'm also heartened by the fact that I factually saw people mm-hmm. making comments on that stop bav page saying you're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong. You're wrong.
Mm-hmm.
At least that.
Yeah.
Okay. Once
the
we've acknowledged,
they don't have a moral compass, so they're okay with posting and
correct. And some people do.
Mm-hmm.
So let's concentrate on the people who have the moral compass mm-hmm. and try to find a way to make things happen. I don't think people are aware, for instance, that the Attorney General's ministry mm-hmm. has a drafting division of about maybe two or three people. That means these two or three people are the technical experts who get to write laws for the entire country on everything mm-hmm. that there is.
And the political will it takes once a draft is established, because there's some drafts that have been there for many, many years.
And I promise you on this one, I will make sure there is the political will to change it. I will personally mm-hmm. put myself in there to be involved. I will personally sit down with people and write drafts of the law. After we've submitted it to government, it's then their responsibility to take it forward. But for those of you who think it can't be done, in 1989, that is what, 30 years ago, mm-hmm. as a young lawyer just coming back, I became aware that there was no domestic violence law.
Mm-hmm.
And I sat down along with Dolores Balderamos Garcia, locked ourselves in a room, got drafts. After we've had a meeting with experts to say what works, what doesn't work,
mm-hmm.
and we wrote the first domestic violence act and gave it to government. And I will never forget that Remigio Montejo, God rest the dead, who was then minister mm-hmm. in charge of the women's department, as it was then called, took that thing to cabinet, and we got 90% of what we wanted in there.
Mm-hmm.
So don't tell me it can't be done.
Mm-hmm.
Additionally, I've written the sexual harassment law,
mm-hmm.
and it's on the books. The problem is there are no regulations.
So how can people translate
the
hashtags and the likes and the shares and
lobby,
all the non-action
lobby
things
your
into
minister.
Action?
Well, first of all, be personally responsible. Don't share, don't post, report.
Mm-hmm.
One, you want to do something. Two, if you see it happen and you know who did it, tell the person that they are wrong.
Yeah.
If you know it is involving a child and you know who did it, report it to the police.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? They don't have to use you as a witness, but at least having the info, they can track it down. All right? Lobby your minister. Lobby your area representative to let them know you need this as a law. Because politicians do listen. I can tell you, for those who think that ranting on Facebook does nothing, I beg to differ. When politicians see that there is critical mass on social media, they do react. I've seen it happen.
Mm-hmm. I have one final point, and it would be remiss of me to not bring it up.
Sure.
Because we've had many forums here with young
yes.
people. This is not, I mean, we're seeing it as it is over the weekend, but in fact, the distribution, the sharing of nude pictures is actually far more common among young people than
no,
we think.
Absolutely.
So the potential for the revenge porn is, I know women who have been blackmailed because of the images.
Yeah.
So
someone sent me a case of a teenager who was blackmailed into producing those images,
mm-hmm.
and she eventually took her own life. Okay?
The point is that
yes.
we know where we are talking about as adults, because we grew up in a different reality. For young people, this is a norm in relationships.
My love,
my
nieces are 13 and 15, and they talk to me.
Yeah.
They tell me things
yeah.
sometimes before they tell their mother.
The girls,
and I'm sorry,
we have a girls forum.
Tia, this boy want I send pictures,
yep.
and he tell me that, you know, I like me, he broke up with me, if I not send him pictures, and I said, what you do? She said, well, I'm not going to send him pictures. I said, well, good for you.
And that's where I wanted to say, because I think the girls' forum opened my eyes when we had it
yes.
last year, where these girls were saying they're looking at 4 to 5 times a week that they're seeing someone else's
standard.
Nudes
yes.
because of how much it is disseminated among
because
people.
Because it's now become a part of the courting
culture.
Exactly.
So talking to parents, about talking to their children, about the choices
yes.
that they make.
Yes.
Because, yes, while we want to talk about the responsibility of those who mm-hmm. possess them, you are in a better position if you don't give someone that ammunition, especially as children.
You want me to tell you? All of those young people out there who are requesting and coercing other young people to produce images, all of that is covered under the Commercial Sexual Exploitation Act. No make the name fool you. It doesn't have to be for commercial purposes. Even if you're doing it for private purposes, you can be charged and you can be convicted. Now, it would be sad if something that young people are doing in and of themselves gets targeted before the commercial
yeah.
exploitation. But that's the way the law is written.
Yeah.
It allows for that kind of prosecution to occur.
Yeah.
The problem, as I've said, and I don't blame the police for this, it's a matter of resources. There's no cybercrime unit
yeah.
as such to be able to monitor this kind of traffic.
That allows us to get away with
yeah.
a lot of things.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, I'm sorry, if I had a teenager, I would have complete access to your phone. That's
and
not even a maybe.
And have the difficult conversation. Don't pretend it isn't happening.
Yes.
It is happening.
Yes.
It is from from the mouth of the babes themselves, from the babies themselves. They are saying that they're doing it. So please teach them, talk to them.
It starts younger than you even
yeah.
know.
Yes.
You know, but I don't want to seem as though I'm beating up on young people, because young people only model what they see
yeah.
adults do.
Yeah.
All right.
And that's where it comes right back to personal responsibility.
So Lisa, we hope that we can have you back once
you
have a more, or once you move on to your path of getting the draft for
and it's not going to be overnight.
Yeah.
Let's not fool ourselves
yeah.
because it's more important to get it right and to get it fast.
Yeah.
So I've also spoken to a couple people in the Bar Association, and I'm going to be asking them to review the legislation too.
Okay.
I'm not a draftsperson. I've done this on a strictly amateur basis.
Mm-hmm.
But even as an amateur, you already know what works and what
yeah.
doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bar will be, as they have in the past, people criticize the Bar for doing nothing. Most of the time, the Bar does its work very quietly and out of the limelight.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm grateful to them for agreeing to review whatever it is we come up with. We have to get it right.
Thank you. Perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We're going to go ahead and take a break. And when we come back, we'll be joined by representatives of the Belize School Counselor Association. That's coming up after the break. Stay tuned.